Good morning, Karen, and good morning to your televiewers.
All right, now the IBP, along with other groups, have expressed support, admiration for the statement and the condemnation that the Supreme Court has issued recently. But let's move forward from that particular statement now. What institutional changes do you believe should be taken to actually, frankly speaking, protect the lives of lawyers, judges, and justices? Let's take it one by one, sir.
Well, the number one step that has to be taken is to do justice release. Mm-hmm. You know, no amount of condemnation, public statements, and resolutions will change the mindset of the criminals if mm-hmm. they know that they can get away with it. So that's the first step that the lawyers, the prosecutors, the judges must all work together, both the executive, legislative, and the judicial branch, to deliver criminal justice quickly in this country. It takes us too long to prosecute. It takes too long for the law enforcers to identify and arrest the suspects and to charge them before the courts. And when they're in the courts, it also takes too long for the judges to resolve the cases.
Okay, that's number one. What else? Because so far, I'll give you some that essentially the Supreme Court had enumerated. No, number one is the wearing of body cams. I think by the wearing of body cams by lawyers. Do you believe that this will actually help or work?
We actually recommended that, Karen, but it's not okay. Wearing of body cams by lawyers. The recommendation of IBP is the wearing of body cams by law enforcers serving warrants of arrest or search warrants to avoid abuse. And at the same time also, it protects the servers of the search warrant from unfounded accusations.
Okay, but do you believe that will actually happen? I mean, frankly speaking, around 2 years ago, if I remember, a budget was already set aside for body cams for police officers to be used during drug raids. And so far, we have not seen the arrival of those body cams en masse.
Now, let me correct you on that.
Oh, but go ahead.
Cameras, body cams, were actually purchased by government. They were tested. Unfortunately, they were not largely used. And in our meeting with the Chief PNP, OIC General, Chief PNP General Elizar in Camp Rame last week, we brought this up before them and said, you know, sayang lang yung mga yan, pwede namang gamitin dun sa mga nagserve. And they have no objection to that. So it's just perhaps, you know, using them, not perhaps for all the operations because there's simply too many policemen in this country, only for those who will serve the warrants of arrest or search warrants. Mm-hmm. Hindi naman ganun karami. So they might have enough body cams for them already. So we hope that the Supreme Court, they are now studying our proposal. PNP, as far as they're concerned, when we discuss this with the top leadership, wala namang problema sa kanya. So it's a small step, but it's in the right direction.
Okay, what other proposals did you submit, attorney?
The other one, of course, is to monitor the cases being handled by the prosecutors. Mm-hmm. And DOJ is already doing that because some of these cases are also languishing before their offices. We monitor the cases already in court, and the Supreme Court has already issued the directive. But it should not stop there. They should be asked to explain bakit tumatagal yan and if there are problems so that we can proactively address the problems. For example, Karen, walang testigo, takot ang testigo, walang pamasahe. IBP put up a 25 million fund for that para lang kumalaw mga ito. So these are concrete steps. So we need a concerted effort. Hindi pwedeng isang sector lang. And IBP is trying to put together all the necessary parties because this is primarily a government function, not the function of IBP.
Okay. Now, based on consolidated data, there so far been 61 lawyers, judges, prosecutors killed in the last 5 years of the Duterte administration. Do you have that same number too?
Yes, we have seen the numbers. There are slight differences thereabouts, but wouldn't that be, is it that far too many killings in a span of like 5 years. So whether it is lawyers or any ordinary Filipino citizen, we should always push back when violence is committed. And more importantly, Karen, when there is impunity, when nobody is held accountable. And that's what's breeding all this culture of violence and attacks all over the country, not only on lawyers and judges, but to ordinary citizens. Mas malala pa ang nangyayari sa ordinaryo mamamayan.
Okay. Now, to be fair, if you look at the last administration, the Aquino administration, it also lugs in, if you have the same numbers as I do, it was 49 deaths, no, in the legal profession. But do you believe that the president's rhetoric plays a role in the increasing number of these deaths?
Possibly, but if you look at the statistics, this has happened even before Aquino, all the presidents. Okay. And to our mind, if it is not decisively addressed, the biggest setback dito is that the country loses faith in our justice system. Mm-hmm. If the administrators of justice, the prime personalities in running the justice system, judges, prosecutors, lawyers, are killed and attacked with impunity, sino ang maniniwala sa batas, Karen? Sino ang maniniwala sa gobyerno? Sino maniniwala sa justisya? That's the big agenda.
Oh. And institutionally, how do you believe should the Supreme Court or the legal profession in general move forward in terms of red baiting your colleagues, no? For example, the Supreme Court said it would investigate the red baiting of Judge Ignacio, right? And, we're talking about petitioners against the anti-terror law, polarization by red baiting, red tagging individuals that essentially would push you not to do your job, so to speak, and the decisions that were handed out by Judge Ignacio have now been put in this box as he supports the left or she is a communist supporter. Anong action dapat pag ni-red bait ang isang judge o justice?
One, Karen, there should be immediate, vigorous, consistent pushback. In the case of Judge Ignacio, IBP did not wait for statements. The IBP passing chapter coordinated with the local authorities and we had it taken down immediately. So yung salita is okay, but the action is more important. So we took it out and nobody's complaining. But again, I say it's very important that not only the legal profession, but everyone else. And we're very thankful to MEJA because you support us when we stand against red tagging. And it should be consistent. It should not only be IBP. It should not only be the president of IBP. Everybody else. There's so many political leaders, lawyers in high positions, a position of power. They have a pulpit. We encourage them to speak out because this is an attack on our rule of law.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to be consistent on this. We have to be very immediate. And we have to make people accountable.
Okay. Here's a question, from a viewer. Right now, because of the COVID situation, you also have courts having less manpower. You agree?
That's true. It's required by the guidelines.
Yes. And because of less manpower, it's assumed, ang sabi ng texter, is lalong mas mabagal ngayon ang pagresolba ng kaso.
It's possible, but you know what we have done, Karen, is right at the very start when there were lockdowns, IBP immediately requested the Supreme Court and other government agencies, tribunals, to consider using online processes. It took them a while, but eventually we were consistent in our prodding. We were providing possible rules, and eventually the Supreme Court heeded. They issued the rules. And now practically all tribunals, quasi-judicial bodies, administrative bodies are now adopting online processes. So nakakatulong yon. Ang problema kung minsan, yung infrastructure. Even if the lawyers now and the judges and all the tribunals are willing to use that, limited yung connectivity. But it helps. So these are the proactive measures that we are pursuing. so that yung justice na mabagal na, hindi titigil o mas lalong babagal.
Adaptation. Okay. Now, what's interesting is also some of your colleagues have said this statement coming from the Supreme Court would also mean possibly that it wants to strengthen the pending writs that may have been viewed as weak. How do you believe that will change everything?
Well, it surely would help, you know, if they improve the rules so that the processes to access or to get these writs will be faster, less technicalities. So again, it boils down. So if they can simplify it, okay, why? Because that's purely within their power. So the processes in our legal system, in the judiciary, kaya nilang palitan yan. If they do that, they have all the support of the Filipino lawyers.
Is this enough? Because Congressman Zarate says this is not enough.
Well, it is not enough. It will not assure every lawyer that these attacks will not happen. And that's why also our advice to our fellow lawyers is let's live by our professional ethics. Let's live the life of a good Filipino lawyer so that nobody will have any reason to harm us. But even if you're a good Filipino lawyer, Karen, you're doing your job, you also get attacked. What's the solution to that? We make sure that whoever does that will be identified, apprehended, charged, and put in jail. Mm-hmm. Unless that happens, no amount of interviews or statements or changes in the rules will stop these attacks.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining us this morning, sir. God bless you, and you stay strong and you stay safe.